I'll be presenting to you an overview of the C-level products. It's more generic overview, and if you have more technical questions about the data formats and their use, come and see me this afternoon. So the main objective of the C-level TAC is to provide, in an operational context, a C-level product for CMEMS. Internal and external users, and we're working with CNES, which is the historical agency producing those products, and also with IMEDEA or SOCIB, LEGOS and L'Océan for the quality control and improvement of the data. So we have global products, either along track and gridded. For now, the gridded data are internal products, but in 1 month, there will be external products. So I'll be talking as if they're already available. And we also have regional products over the European seas, the Europe region, including the EB area, Arctic, Mediterranean Sea, and Black Sea. And those regional products have specific content and specific processing applied. So just now, the products are sea level anomalies. Sometimes you will see them called sea surface 8 anomalies. It's the same. And mostly they are sea surface 8 with respect to the to a multi-year mean. Just now we are using a 20-year mean from 92 to 2012. The data are those measured by satellite radar altimetry, and they are highly processed. And you can find them in the CMEMS catalog by choosing observation, sea level, and surface observation, in fact. So just a few words about satellite radar altimetry. I don't know if you know much about it, but so I present the basics. So the principle of altimetry is that we are measuring the distance between the satellites to the surface by using a radar wave, and we have also a very precise way of having the altitude of the satellite, and by subtracting both, we reach the sea surface 8. So the sea surface 8 in altimetry is different. Sometimes you see SSH for what we are calling dynamic topography. So sometimes it's misleading, but we are all wrong. We should say sea surface 8 with respect to. So in altimetry, we are talking sea surface 8 with respect to a reference ellipsoid. And for the processing, we are applying a bunch of correction, taking into account the atmospheric effect on the wave speed. Also, the fact that we have surface effects, geophysical effects like tides. Sometimes we want to study tides, but sometimes we don't. So we have to remove the tides from the sea surface 8. And also several things that happen in the ionosphere and things like that. So just a reminder, satellite altimetry is not imagery. The data are along track, which means the data are basically something like this, with some gaps in between. It depends on the satellites, but you can have up to 315 kilometers between two tracks at the equator. So we are mostly using images, fully colored images when we are showing altimetry results, but basically this is what altimetry measurements are looking like. So just a few words about the data processing for the C-level attack. So we are using a processing segment that have been sought in 98 for a European Commission project. Then it became part of the CNES ground segment with two components, a real-time component for operational application and a delay time or reprocessed component for climate applications. And since 2008, it's the backbone of the sea level attack for the what was MyOcean and which is now CMEMS. So the processing is, we are starting from a long track level 2 data made by the space agencies. Those are complex data with something like 100, 120 parameters or even more. And they are non-homogeneous data sets regarding format, reference, and so on. So you can have something like 40 centimeters between two different missions, for example, or you can have old-fashioned binaries for TOPEX Poseidon and NetCDF for JSON 2 and so on. So it's a bit difficult to work with all those data. So the first step we are taking is to homogeneize all the data as far as orbit, reference, instrumental, and correction are involved, so as to have homogeneous data, which at this stage is still a long track. Then we are cross-calibrating the data, so as to have a number, not to have biases between the different missions, and with those, we make the level 3 or along track data, which are distributed through CMEMS. And the last step is multi-altimeter merging, which leads to level 4 or gridded maps, which will soon be available through CMEMS. And then for some other project, we are making even more processed data, which are distributed on different platforms or could be distributed as indicators, for example, for CMEMS. So why, to illustrate a bit the need for homogenization and cross-calibration, I hope you see the different colors. So these are the same period for three different satellites, JSON 2, SARAL, which is CNES ISRO satellite, and HY2, which is a Chinese satellite. And you see here, you've got, with the same color bar, you've got difference in color. Here you have several colors, and this one is only blue, because there's a biases. So, you also have several spurious data here and there, and things like that. So that's why we are homogenizing the data, so as to have here, you see all the satellites on the same map with homogeneous standards, so that it's completely coherent on the same regions. And those data can be used without more processing within the ocean models. Then the other step we are making is to merge the different satellites. The idea is that here we have interesting features, but by using optimal interpolation, we are managing to have even better resolution, so as to have more details and to have an easier to use data set too. So as I said, they will be available in about 1 month in CMEMS. So I said earlier that we have two different processing, near real time and what we call delayed or reprocessed products. Just a word of warning, the near real time products, they are produced every day for the current day and the past six days. But note that those data are by definition uncentered. You have only either 0 days or 6 days at the most of data after the measurement, and we are using 6 weeks of data before the measurement. So you've got a shift in the window used to process the data. So, and the data we're using for those data are slightly lower quality because we have a less precise orbit determination. So those data are highly sensitive to the number of satellites which are currently working. Just now we are rich with satellites because we've got four of them. But at some point in the past 20 years, we had some period with less satellites. So it can be tricky at times. The other kind of data are the reprocessed product. And for those data, we are using a centered window with 6 weeks before and six weeks after of data to determine the day which the data is dated from. So this is not a mean exactly, but we are using the information from a long track data for the past and future of the maps we are producing. But for that, we need the whole set of satellites level 2 data fully validated with precise orbit. So this means, for all those reasons here, that we can't have reprocessed data before several months after the date they are dated from. So we can't provide you with reprocessed data 1 week after the measurement. It's not possible because all the processing, all the quality control need time, including to have a very precise orbit. And those data, we are having them from January 1993, and we are doing reprocessing about every 4 years to take into account all the new research on data quality, on the different correction, and so on. So the idea is that each time we are doing a reprocessing, we will reprocess the whole data set from 93. So this is a bit of a heavy kind of reprocessing, but it means you always have this data set fully and completely homogeneous in processing, in quality, and so on. Next reprocessing is planned for 2019. So just now we've got those satellites ongoing. We had all those in the past. And I'll give you a little word on the next two ones afterwards. But just now we've got JSON-2 Cryosat, which is from ESA, HY2 from China, and SARAL, which is a French Indian satellite. So they're still ongoing with sometimes some problems, sometimes they're working well. Those are satellites. So the next two ones are JSON-3 and Sentinel-3A. So JSON-3 is a copy of JSON-2, which was mostly a copy of JSON-1. So they're fully homogeneous. It will be launched on the same tracks than TOPEX and Poseidon, JSON 1 and JSON 2. And so we'll have 30 years of fully homogeneous, continuous data set at the end of JSON 3 lifetime. And once we will be sure that JSON 3 is giving good measurement, JSON 2 will be shifted on a new orbit so as to give even more resolution and even more data. The continuity should be ensured by JSON CS, or also named Sentinel 6. And it's supposed to be launched in mid-January. For now, we are shifting the launch date from day to day, so I can't be sure of the launch date. Sentinel-3 is currently supposed to be launched on February 4, with several sensors on board to serve mostly CMEMS, in fact. And it's a completely new platform, so we are expecting to put the data within CMEMS much later than JSON 3, because JSON 3 is a known sensor, known satellite. So in 2 or 3 months, we should be able to use the data within the operational processing. But Sentinel 3, it will take more time. And just a few words on application. I will go a bit quick on those. So with altimetry, you can see the major current by as earth and trough on the ocean, which means you've got something like this for the Gulf Stream. But if you are looking along track, as I said, it's a basic data format, you see something like this with what we had, here, it's lower, it's higher. So you find it's the lower C-surface 8 and the higher one along the track on different months, sorry, in French. You can see also things like seasonal shift of current, for example, with monsoon in summer and in winter, and the currents are shifting due to the winds and sea surface temperature. From year to year, you see also the difference between the different currents. Here, it's a Kuroshio path. So depending on the year, you have a narrower current, like here, or much more spread currents, like here. So depending on the year, you will be seeing different things. So having the longer time series is always interesting, and studying those. One of the more classical application of altimetry is El Nino. So in 97-98, we had a major event. You are finding it here. And just now we have another major event, which is slightly different from the 97 one, but which promised to be quite a big event too. Another thing we can see with altimetry is planetary waves. So when we do a longitude time diagram, we see the different moves of surface elevation as straight lines, and we can compare it, for example, with chlorophyll ones. Or just look at the different propagation of such things. And note that before altimetry, those planetary waves were theoretically predicted, but nobody had ever seen them. So another classical application of altimetry is the mean sea level. So those are the current observation with a error of 0.5 millimeter per year, and an inhomogeneous distribution in space. So those data, this map is directly made from data which will be distributed through CMEMS, which are the grids. We can also see, compare the altimetry C-surface 8 with in-situ data, and we see that by adding, by using more satellites, we've got a better fit. Here you have a comparison with only two satellites, GISM1 and ERS2, and here with three satellites, and you see that the path of the drifter is better correlated with the surface 8 with three satellites and with only two. And we have several examples like that, and that shows that with more satellites within the grid, we have a better resolution and better details within the data. And we can also compare, we can say it's an in-situ things with an oil drift from the deep water horizon. And you see the currents derived from altimetric sea surface 8. And you see that the oil drift is going around, following the currents predicted by, measured by altimetry. We can also have some information which can help to forecast the strength of tropical cyclones. So you see here an example with Katrina. And in fact, Katrina in 2005, Katrina intensified just above warm eddy, which was really very well seen in altimetry, but not seen at all in sea surface temperature, which is mostly homogeneous in the area at this period. We can also compare with other in-situ measurement, if you want, with animals. So this is the track of leatherback turtle. And this leatherback turtle, when up north, and when meeting with the Gulf Stream front, it began to follow the meanders of the currents, probably feeding in it. And knowing or not if it was in a current, we don't really know, but mostly because it was finding more feed in there. We also have comparison with chlorophyll data and with regional data which are not in CMEMS but which are made for ocean campaign, because we are doing specific data and a lot of users are using altimetry data to better fit the launch of buoys or trackers or drifters within the ocean during at sea campaigns. And we can also help optimize the maritime route, even if models are better fit for that, or locate fishing grounds. And last but not least, just a few words for assimilation in ocean model, because this is one of the major applications of the level 3 along track data, which are now in CMEMS, especially the near real time ones. So the idea is that the models need in situ, as was said earlier, but also satellites to better fit the forecast, to keep the models on the as close as possible to reality. So the altimetry helps by adding information, integrated information above on the, all the water column, and by adding more satellites, you see that you're adding information in the model. Those are modal output with or without a difference between modal output with assimilating several data and without assimilating it. So you see, you are having more information, adding more satellites. So just now we've got four. In several months, we hope we will have five of the, or even six of them, which will be a very first thing in the history of altimetry, having six satellites working together, so we hope. And so we will have a whole bunch of new things to discover with and to forecast with altimetry. And if you have more if you want more information, details, questions, demos, and so on, please go and see me this afternoon in room 2.2. Thank you.